everybody getting up early in the morning and finding their way to these beautiful places. So yesterday what I did was I talked about Schurball duality, the duality between a group and its action on a tensor space, the centralizer algebra, and using high quiver to get information about the centralizer algebra. At the end, I was talking about fundamental theorems of invariant theory, and I just want to summarize a little bit where we were. So I didn't realize there wasn't going to be a board here, so I'm now doing a multimedia. So we have a vector space, just n-dimensional space over a field of characteristic zero. And we have lots of things acting on the tensor space. So when we act with the general linear group, the things that centralize that are basically coming from the group algebra, the symmetric group SK, that's acting as place permutations. When we go down to the orthogonal group, then what it's commuting with that action is something called the Brouwer algebra. And when we go down even further to the symmetric group, what's commuting with that is a bigger algebra called the partition algebra. And so when we have this descending chain of groups on the left, we have an ascending chain of algebras on the right. So, switch me. excuse me, one further thing. So these are the homomorphisms we had. So in the first case, this is the action of the group algebra, the symmetric group, acting on V tensor K, and that centralizer algebra, that endomorphism algebra, is actually the invariance on the right. And so we're saying that you can use the group algebra, the symmetric group, and its generators of relations to describe these invariants. The kernel is zero, so actually you can identify these invariants with this group algebra, the symmetric group. If n is not bigger than k, in other words, if k is bigger than n, which is probably more what you would think, because you're fixing the group Sn and you're letting k get larger and larger, then you do get a kernel. And the kernel is generated by this one essential idempotent, the anti-symmetrizer. And that's the same one you just consider it embedded for all k greater than n. So this is the first place the kernel. In the Brouwer case, it's a somewhat similar situation. Because we have a bilinear form, symmetric, non-degenerate bilinear form on V, we can identify the dual with the vector space V as a G module. So actually what we're getting is invariance in V tensor 2K. And again, the kernel of this map is zero if n is greater than or equal to k. And if not, it's generated by an idempotent. And this idempotent is the result of a bunch of work in the last about 10 years. And it's not that easy to describe. So I'm going to not describe it. What about the partition algebra case? Well, very similar thing is happening. V is isomorphic to its dual here. And so when we're looking at the centralizer algebra, we're really looking at invariance of V tensor 2K under the symmetric loop action. Now, this is a different action than we saw in the general linear case. Because in the general linear case, we're permuting the factors. And here, we're acting diagonally on So the kernel is zero if n is greater than or equal to 2k here, and that's one of the complications. And it's generated by an idempotent if 2k is greater than n. So one of my goals is to describe this idempotent and to tell you a little bit about the partition algebra. And then I'm going to go back and sort of redo some of the things I did yesterday, but in a different context. Okay. Wow, two people agree. Okay. You want to? Partition algebras. So these aren't what you think they are. The partitions are actually set partitions. So you have a set of 2k size, and you're partitioning it into non-empty disjoint subsets. So there's a set partition where I've just partitioned the numbers from 1 up to 16 into various subsets. And then I want to think about that diagrammatically, where I just connect things that are in the same block. And it's not going to matter how you connect them. The important thing is that things in the same block are connected somehow. So the partition algebra has a basis of these diagrams. And you remember in our Tower of Algebras that the partition algebra contained the Brouwer algebra. Those are the diagrams that exactly have each node connected to one other node. So it's an exact matching. And they can match horizontally or vertically. The symmetric group algebra has basis the diagrams that are just vertical connection. One node is connected to the node up on top. One node on the bottom is connected to exactly one node on the bottom. Okay. So these diagrams contain Brouwer algebra, symmetric group. The dimension is the Stirling numbers of the second kind. So that's the number of ways of partitioning a set of size 2k into j disjoint subsets. And that sum there is something called the Bell number, B2K. Maybe some of you have come across Bell numbers. Doesn't ring a bell. Okay. Multiplication is given in the following way. You take two diagrams and you just stack them. Okay. So this one is on the bottom. This one's on the top. And then basically you just follow paths. And that's this path. So you're concatenating the edges. This node will find its way back up to there and be just a double. But there are two blocks here that lie entirely in the middle and don't show up in the final answer. And that's the parameter n, pkn, to those two blocks. So that's also the multiplication in the Brouwer algebra. Well, that basis is terrific, and everybody uses it about 99% of the time. But there's another basis. And the other basis is called the orbit basis. And there's a coarsening relation where we say V rho is greater than pi if it's gotten by merging blocks. So you notice I merged the second and third block and the last two blocks. I could have also done something where, for example, I could have merged the 5 and the 7 with the 1 and the 10. So what this orbit basis is it's actually defined by this relation. And the way to see it, this is the basis that actually von Jones started with, this orbit basis. So if I have this diagram, which there it is, it's got three blocks. It's equal to orbit, so I'm using white circles to be orbit basis diagrams. So I've merged, in the second one I've merged the first two blocks, and the third one I've merged the last two blocks, and then in the fourth term I've merged the first and the last block. So if you order your diagrams from the least blocks to the most blocks, the transition matrix between these two bases is upper triangular. And so you can get one from the other. And getting one from the other involves coefficients when you go the other direction. So when you write an orbit basis element in terms of diagram basis elements, you get a coefficient, and this is the ith block of the new one, is the merger of bi blocks of the old. So then you have to compute that coefficient for each thing that's on the right hand side. Okay, so can I switch? Sorry, this is the last time I'm going to switch. I think. So, the diagram basis element with all vertical edges is the identity. Okay. What about this guy? So this is not the identity. It's not the identity even in the orbit basis. It's actually a sum of diagrams. Remember, we have to get from one to the other by coarsening things, so we're joining together these vertical lines. And if we join together J, so we have J blocks, then that's again one of these Stirling numbers. So the number of terms in this diagram is actually another Bell number. There are an enormous number of terms here. And they all have coefficients from that mu, the Möbius function. Okay, so I want to describe a little bit von Jones's work that's giving us these fundamental theorems of invariant theory. So von Jones is describing a homomorphism, algebra homomorphism, between this partition algebra and the centralizer algebra. And I'm writing it in terms of certain coefficients times matrix units. Remember, these are transformations. So certain coefficients times matrix units. And these R's are tuples from 1 to n. And they're k-tuples. So where these k-tuples are coming from is if you had a basis for B, if you had a basis And this is how you do it. So you just think of those subscripts and put them down on the bottom of your orbit diagram. Put the ones where you're going on the top. So the bottom is my R bar, or underline R, and the top is my underline R prime. And then this coefficient is 1 if labels that are connected have the same, if these subscripts that are connected have the same label. So R2 and R3 have to have the same entry. R5, R9, and R10 have to have the same number attached to them. And so where Von Jones, or how he was thinking about this is, look, I can label the first one, R1 and R7, with a 1, R2 and R3 with a 2, R4, R6, R8 with 3, and R5, R9, R10 with a 4. That's one of the terms in this sum up here that has a coefficient of 1. And then every other one is an orbit obtained by applying an element of Sn to that one. So that's where the word orbit comes from. And that's his way of thinking that this is how this map is defined. So this transformation, in fact, is onto. And the kernel is a span of these orbit diagrams where the set partition has more than n blocks. Because if I have more than n blocks, well, I can't label them with the same labels. That's a problem. Okay. So I think I'm done with the with that, and I'll go back to. We have to add to get to the generators and relations of the invariants. So here are some essential items for doing that. So if you remember, where does the kernel start? It starts where 2k is bigger than n. So the first place it starts is where 2k is greater than or equal to n plus 1. In other words, 2k minus 1 is greater than n. So for example, when k is 3, 2k minus 1 is 5. So it always starts with this thing of all empty and climbs its way up to that diagram that I was trying to convince you of, that it's got a huge number of terms. Okay? So I hope you have this all memorized. So the fundamental theorems of invariant theory for the symmetric group. The first one is due to Von Jones and these ideas of that there's this surjection that we saw. It's an isomorphism when n is greater than or equal to 2k. So Paul Martin, who did a lot of early work on the partition algebra related to Hott's model of interacting spins, says if Hott's kernel, so this is the kernel of this map, is idempotently generated, this is conjecture. the second fundamental theorem will tell us what else we have to do to add to this. And this is the result with Tom Halvorsen. So the image, which is the invariance, is generated by the partition algebra and some set of generators and relations, together with one additional relation when E, when 2k is greater than n. And the one additional relation is that I don't know. And in fact, when k is greater than or equal to n, you can replace it with exactly 1. I'm going to go back just a second to that picture of those essential items. So these are the ones that are generating the kernel. And when you have n equal k, it's always going to be the diagram with a pair of empty dots and then the vertical edge. That's the essential idempotent. And what I wanted to convince you of is that that's a sum of a huge number of diagrams with coefficients. And probably if you went to look for the generator of the kernel and using the diagram basis, you probably would not have found it. It's just translating even in small cases. But the orbit basis, which is really the philosophy here, if you're working with this homomorphism to the centralizer algebra, is the best thing to do. Okay. So I'm going to stop that and go back to something I did yesterday. This is some work by Grinberg, Huang, and Reiner. It's generalizing everything I talked about yesterday and something I didn't talk about yesterday, and that is that these matrices that we get, the adjacency matrices for the Mackay quivers, are very interesting matrices. And in a paper, the BKR, there's some work I did with Carly Clivens and Vic Reiner, where we looked at chip firing and gave a dynamics to those Mackay quivers. All this is what Grinberg, Huang, and Reiner are generalizing. So yesterday I was working with groups over field of characteristic zero. Let's just work with any finite dimensional Hopf algebra. Any finite dimensional module for it. Let's take the simple modules and the projective and decomposable covers for them. Then in the growth indie group, we can multiply Si and V, equivalent to taking the tensor product, get a non-negative integer combination of the Sj's, and use those Aij's to construct a quiver. Okay. Now again, what's kind of interesting is these dimensions of these simples again form an eigenvector with eigenvalue dimension b. Remember, the start of all that was the marks on the Dicke diagram, and the marks gave an eigenvector under the Mackay correspondence. A left eigenvector is given by the dimensions of the projectives. And again, it's the same eigenvalue. Thank you. Denver case. And so here I'm going to talk about things that were, are like what Chris was talking about yesterday, looking at modular representations. So here the symbols correspond to P regular elements, P prime elements. The order is relatively prime to the prime you're working with. So they're in one-to-one correspondence with the symbols. We have the characters, our characters. Now the characters of the indecomposables and also their left duals. So the left duals come in because we're sort of flipping things over to the left side. So what Grinberg, Huang, and Reiner show is that the adjacency matrix of this Mackay cover for G and V has eigenvectors that are exactly the columns of the Brauer character table. So this is what we saw yesterday. If you want to just think of the characteristic zero cases, it's the same thing as what's going on here. But you're working with all the characters. The eigenvalue, again, depends on V. The eigenvectors do not. So no matter which V you choose, it's the same set of eigenvectors. And these left duals give the left eigenvectors for these adjacencies. I want to talk about some really joint ongoing work with Percy Diaconis, Martin Liebig, and Pam Kiep. Kind of an odd conglomeration of people there. So I saw Percy and he said, I'm interested in walking. Walks on associated to groups. And I said, oh, I know something about that. And he said, okay. We got to talk. The only thing is, anytime Percy says walking, he means random walking. So it's a slightly different kind of walking. So a combinatorial hop algebra, a hop algebra can yield a natural Markov chain, which is sometimes interesting, sometimes explicitly analyzable. So I want to illustrate this with an example to get started. Suppose we take SL2 p squared. P here is an odd prime, bigger than 3. We saw in Chris's talk yesterday that the simple modules by Steinberg's tensor product theorem are simples, these LAs, where A is between 0 and p minus 1, so that's just like the SL2 case, and then the Frobenius twist of another one, applying P to all the matrices representing those elements of the group acting on that module. So the Mackay quiver for P equals 5 and the natural two-dimensional representation is this. So when you're walking, moving around on this one, this is where you are. And you notice that sort of when you hit the wall over here, you're bouncing back with 2 arrows, and then either bouncing up or down, depending on which way you choose. Now, if I just wanted SL2P, I would take this bottom row, just the first coordinate, and I go up here, over here, and down here. So that's the quiver. example. SL2, too cute. High quiver for the two-dimensional natural module. The dotted lines are there just for, give us a little frame of reference. And you see, coming into here, there are lots of arrows coming in. Again, the Steinberg modules, which is up there, has got lots of arrows coming down. Now you can do this with any representation you want. You can label the nodes with symbols, you could label the nodes with projectives if you want. A tensor with projective module. Use tilting modules, you could do all sorts of things. So modular results, if we take the Brouwer characters of G corresponding to symbols. So these are defined only on the P regular conjugacy classes. So the elements are relatively prime to P. Take some representatives. Take the characters corresponding to the projectives. You could take the characters corresponding to their duals. That's just a permutation. Then the matrix of the Mackay quiver. Determined by this information. Well, if you want to know, like we did yesterday, what the IJ entry is of A to the K, that's just this composition. And again, the way we showed this result in the non-modular case was using your orthogonality of characters. Here, there is an orthogonality of characters, but it involves the projectives. So this is kind of the equivalent statement of what we had yesterday. And then from there you can derive things. For example, you could replace this character with the sum of characters of simple modules by using the Cartan matrix. Mm-hmm. You can put it either out or in, depending on your taste. Okay. So basically, you can carry over a lot of what we did yesterday to this setting. The formulas are not so nice because they involve these sums involving these Cartan matrix. But nevertheless, you know, it works.
This only depends on the comp factors in V, is that?
I'm sorry.
This only depends on the composition factors in V, is that?
That's right. From I to J. Remember, our quiver has nodes corresponding to the simple modules, the Brouwer characters. So the probability of going from I to J is this composition multiplicity, which you sort of expect because there'll be more arrows, together with the dimension of SJ over the dimension of the things you're starting with. Product of those two dimensions. There's something called the stationary distribution. And here, be the dimension of a projective text, the dimension of a simple. If we were in a semi-simple case, this would just be the dimension of the simple square. And you know that the dimension of the simple square, the squares of the simple dimensions of the simples, adds up to the dimension of the algebra. Right? Wedderburn's theorem? So for the group algebra case, the dimension of the algebra is the order of the group. So this is the analog. So the stationary distribution here is just putting those numbers on the nodes. You're thinking of those as corresponding to the nodes. So we'll take our eigenvalues, which are evaluating chi v at a p regular class. We'll take eigenvectors where I've scaled this vector. This is really a common vector, a common of the dimensions of the simples, by 1 over the dimension of v. And scaled the left eigenvector by the order of the centralizer of the element, 1 over that. And then taking these projective character values and multiplying by the dimension of the simple. So probabilists have this annoying habit of wanting everything to add up to 1. And that's what's going on here. So you've just scaled these eigenvectors, which are really very important in doing probability connection, computations. You scale them so they're orthonormal. And so the probability of going from I to J in K steps is the ith entry of that top one, which is essentially the dimension of, or the character value Si, Fc. This term, which is essentially chi v c, okay. And then the left eigenvector entry is basically, without this annoying scaling, the character values of the projectives. And then you say,